Okay, it's time for some quick. Your hero? Duck. Hoo hoo hoo. What a mess. Snap. Crackle. Let's play some Quake. You know, I'm pretty fucking... I think I have to load. Yeah, I had to load an autosave, I think. I gotta say, I'm pretty rubbish at finding the secret levels. Vinny, have you played online Quake? I have, in the past. This is just me going through the single player because I miss Quake. What? Was this where I was? Did you buy an ISP to play it like Rojogan did? Yo, I ran like a T3. $1,000 a month, T3, up to my mountain apartment. It's just interesting to see how first-person shooter campaigns started. Even though this isn't how they started, this just was like a further evolution of it. Compared to where we're at now, where it's like, shoot, have your eyes bleed for a little bit, and then go start shooting again. Then wait a minute, shoot more. Okay, move up. Squad, move up. Alright, your eyes are bleeding. I like games with, like, Half-Life to me is the perfect campaign. It's the perfect mix of storytelling and, is this where I was? I guess this is where I was. The perfect, you know, storytelling, finding weapons, fighting new enemies, learning about the Black Mesa facility. It was fast, kind of like this, but yet it was able to slow down the pace enough that you could, you know, absorb the world a bit and then, like, have a moment to not have to shoot everything. So, yeah, Half-Life was only a couple years after this, too. It's like a huge evolutionary leap. But then, you know, like, iron sights started happening, and I don't hate iron sights. I like them as an option. People get mad at me when I play first-person shooters, because they're like, Vinny, use your iron sights! And I'm like, oh, I'm just so used to not using them. I like to fire from the hip. Can I put points in that perk? I like to put points in the perk that allows me to shoot from the hip in video games that allow me to do so. I also like that, in games with iron sights, I like to be able to shoot and have the spread go out a little bit. So, like, you have perfectly accurate with iron sights, and less so for crowd control when you're not. Always run out of nail gun ammo in this game so quickly. It's very accurate and powerful, so understandably so, but... Also, I think that the shotgun in this game, the double shotgun, is fast. but I still like the Doom 2 double shotgun better. See, a lot of Quake is just gauntlet of enemies, different combat situations, different scenarios, different, like, different makeup of enemies that you have to figure out how to deal with. Like, should I take out this dude first, or that dude, or that dude? Get key, rinse and repeat. Vinny, I know this sounds stupid, but Valve is currently making a Half-Life 2 prequel exclusive for VR. Well, there was a leaked picture of Valve's new VR headset, right? I don't believe that. I know it's a rumor. I think it could be happening. But I would just say, why not make it for mobile? Everyone has phone. Everybody knows the rules. This is like the easiest joke. It's too easy. The mobile thing, the phone thing. I'm extremely guilty of... Oh, I didn't save at all. I did not save once. That's what I get for harping on that joke. That low-hanging fruit. 1-800-FRUIT. Fuck! Not even I hate him. It's not even an 800 number. Vinny, you got electrocuted? You mean I electrocuted myself? I will be saving frequently. Too much? Some of these levels I've never seen before because I played Quake 64 and not the original. I still liked it, so it says a lot about Quake. It was just fun to replay and go shoot things and then try on a harder difficulty. But, I mean... Quake always felt more like a technology thing, rather than like, oh, we're gonna make the best single-player game of all time. It was like, no, we'll do multiplayer and single-player on this new engine that actually is kind of amazing. Hey guys, did you hear that Starfield is gonna be using this engine? It's kinda crazy, right? I think I shooted good just then. Being ammo efficient. Nice. Vinny, has any one single person in chat ever been able to really get under your skin? I wouldn't answer that, even if I did have an answer. Thank you. You. You know who you are. You. Desert. Okay, there's health here. It's gonna be fine. There we go. None of the weapons in this game feel, like, too powerful. Like, they all are pretty much viable. At various times. No, please no. Please no. Please, God, no. Please. What about the basic nail gun? Okay, that one's kind of shit. Mega Man platforms. Basic nail gun would probably be best used with quad damage, like I used it earlier. Because then you're wasting less ammo. Vinny, do the boxes say Nin on them? Yes. Trent Reznor did the soundtrack for this game. So they say Nin. Vinny, if you're playing the Steam version, the soundtrack is missing. I'm playing the Quakegasm version with slightly enhanced lighting. And I am using the Steam version's files to make that happen. And I had to download the soundtrack separately and import it into the game. So believe it or not, you're hearing music right now. What, you don't know what music sounds like? It's there. Why must you choke me out, game? What if I only had, like, 4 HP? Allow me to go back here if there was no secret. I guess there's no secret. Vinny, Trent voiced all of the guns. Pew! He's so good with his studio that he was able to go pew and then mix it into the sound of a gun. You can fuck off, friend. Did you know that Trent Reznor not only did the sound effects, but put a little drop of his blood in every copy of the game? and then there was Sent Presnor and Brent Fresnor. Lots of different dudes worked on this game. It wasn't just one dudes. Give them credit too. Okay, the axe isn't very viable unless you run out of ammo, but even that makes it viable in its own way. Do you remember when the axe used to run at, like, 2 frames a second? Actually, everything did. You kind of got used to it. Vinny, the stream still says Zelda. Fuck, you're right. I knew I forgot to do something during the break. Vinny, where's the music? This is the music. Do you want to hear Trent Reznor whisper in your ear in a sultry manner? The idea that one guy could do the entire sound for an entire video game is mind-blowing to me. I know when I beat Red Dead Redemption 2, the credits, like the sound people, it's gonna be enough to fill like a small city. Vinesauce, we would really love if you could score our game. We've heard some of your music and we think that it would be perfect for this. We can pay you a couple bucks. You know what? I'm in. Time to boot up some algo music. Snap crack hell. It is time. Vinny, wait until you hear about Cave Story. No. I'm talking about, like, you know, AAA productions. Pixel did all the music. Derek Yu, I think, did the music for Spelunky, the original. Well, I don't know if he did. Hang on 1 second. Toby Fox, yes. Now, you know, me just saying that is going to turn into some kind of war about which character is better and who should not be killed, etc., etc., but I do respect the dude greatly for what he was able to accomplish. I have nothing but respect for that level of accomplishment. Someone said, I think you lampshading it makes it worse. Could be. It's debatable. However, you haven't seen my inbox the past 2 weeks. That's all I'm gonna say. And we'll leave it at that. So wait, did Derek Yu do the soundtrack to Spelunky? I don't think he did the one for the 360, which then got ported over to Steam. But I'm pretty sure he did the original game soundtrack. I guess not. I don't know. KY would know. You know, if you're someone who makes music, I want to throw a tip at you. If you can't make a rhythm, or like you're struggling to find a rhythm for your song, throw some echo on a random thingy and see what happens. And then try a couple, then throw echo on another random thingy at half the speed. And you might have something interesting. Echo is really good at getting you some strange little rhythmic things in a bind. So there's a scene in the movie Unforgiven where Gene Hackman is reading a book by some dude who's like a... basically, someone who writes stories about legendary cowboys. I wonder where they got that idea from in Red Dead. And, so the name of the... what's it called? The Duke of Terror, I think, is the name of the book. And Gene Hackman, the sheriff of the town, keeps mispronouncing it on purpose. The Duck. And he's like, actually, it's the Duke. And he's like, well, I says it's the Duck. So then he reads the story, but instead of Duke, he says Duck every time. I was like, oh, I want to read that. I want, like, a duck cowboy. Trust no one, not even yourself. Vinny, did you know that the horses they made in Red Dead Redemption 2 is a real thing? Yo, they turned the horses from that animal in that game into real things that exist in the world? Oh. How'd they do that? I know they had a lot of GTA money from the online service, but I didn't think they could, like, genetically engineer a new creature. That's cool. Can you ride it, like, in the game? Shark cards can create new life. Never complain. Never complain. When Red Dead 2 Online comes out and you have to pay for donkey cards, just know that it can go to create new life. Soon we're gonna have, like, you know, some kind of Jurassic Park, but for cowboys. But they'll be, like, mechanical and, like, robots and stuff. Start to achieve sentience. But no, in all seriousness, there's some good cowboy movies I've never watched. And I'm not really big into westerns. Now I kind of am. Or at least I want to watch a couple more of them. I might watch a couple more of them 70s Clint Eastwoods. Oh yeah, Tombstone's my favorite. Great cast. Did you know that the dude from, Merle from The Walking Dead, what the fuck is that? I always forget that guy's name. He played, the blue fuckface, who was Mary Poppins. Weirdly enough, that is the proper information and enough of it for you to figure out who the character is. Michael Rooker. Michael Rooker was in that Unforgiven movie. I was like, oh shit, he looks young. But also kind of old. There are some actors that just continue to look young because they started old. Like Patrick Stewart. He's been like the same age for years. Vinny, your thoughts on the Westworld set being burnt down? Heard about that. That's a legendary set. And it's gone now in the fucking fires. Yeah, I mean, I'm more concerned about the loss of life, which is fucking terrible on every level. But the set being burned down is just another piece of shit moment. So it's just a shame, man. I like good news. I want good news. What's good news? Yeah. Kirby DLC? Spyro in 2 days, yeah. You know, sometimes they drop keys for video games my way. Well, I get a lot of them. I get a lot of keys. I hope they send me one for Spyro. That would be cool. I'd stream a little bit of it at least. But if they don't, then I'm probably not going to look into it. Sorry to say. Thief Simulator. I'll give you an example. I'm going to sort through a couple of my emails. I just want you to hear about a couple things I got in the past, like, couple days, maybe week. And I don't play a lot of them because it's just too many. And I'm not, like, really into a lot of different genres that they send me. A lot of puzzle games. No Way Out VR. A horror adventure game. They didn't include a trailer. Thief Simulator, I'm interested in. It looks really interesting and could make for a fun stream. Robo puzzle game. Hang on. Got an email here that says, Vinny, are you all right? Well, depends. It depends on what all right means. Augmented reality escape room app for iOS and Android. Hello, Jonathan Vinesauce. Would you like to stream our escape room game? Agony Unrated, which is, I guess, a game called Agony, but now it's unrated. Which could be a good Halloween game for next year. So I'm very lucky that I get these things sent to me, but again, one of the reasons all these things come my way is because I'm on the PAX press list, because I got press passes for PAX a couple years in a row. Now I don't. Now it's like Creator Pass or whatever. I don't even know what the difference is. But I get spammed pretty hard with stuff like that. And it's cool. Sometimes it's a good, interesting game that I find. And sometimes it's of no interest to me and I just, you know, can't stream them all. But it's cool. And sometimes my YouTube network will be like, hey, do you want to do this? We have a couple keys. We have one for Call of Duty Black Ops 4. Do you want it? I'm like, oh, what's this? My previous video got taken down by Activision. Yes, I would love a key. I would love a key for Call of Duty Black Ops 4. And then I ended up liking the game. Go figure. But my, you know, my initial thing is always, am I allowed to speak freely about the game? And the answer is usually yes. And I don't think any publisher wants to be known as the one that's like, No, you can't. Sorry, you can't say anything bad about the game. That would be like real scum hours. But here's a true story. Here's a true story. One time, I got offered a thing, and it was a money thing. I didn't do it. I turned it down. But it was good money. But the way they worded it, it was very flowery language of like, do not be excessively rude about the game. You can be honest, but don't be excessively rude. I'm like, what does that mean? What if the game is shit? How do I say it? And that's the thing, like, I guess it's more just be chill. And I can appreciate that. I understand that. It's like, I'm not gonna be like, your game fucking sucks, man! You know, you just gave me this amount of money, and now I'm gonna say it sucks. Which I'm sure happens. But to this day, I've never accepted a dollar for that. I mean, yay, altruistic Vinny is on the case, but it's just truth. I'd feel too fucking weird about it. And I'm doing fine. I'm bringing home that bread, so it's all good. But I think it's interesting that, you know, they don't outright say you can't shit-talk the game. You can't be excessively shitty about the game. So I guess I'd have to say something like, alright, well, you know, this mechanic doesn't work. This one's kind of stupid. This one's kind of lame. But here's why. I guess. I don't know how that would work. Maybe more like a... Just be nice about it? I don't know. Vinny, as a developer, ever flat out said that you can be as honest as you want, even if you hate the game? Yeah, indie developers usually say that. Constructive criticism, yeah. But indie developers, some of them will tell me to play their game. They're like, yo, it'd be funny if you shat on my game. I like that. The rune of black magic throbs evilly in your hand as whispers and whispers dark thoughts into your brain. You learn the inmost lore of the Hell Mother. Shub Nigoroth. Oh boy. Be very careful. You now know that she is behind all the terrible plotting, which has led to so much death and horror, but she is not inviolate. Armed with this rune, you realize that once all four runes are combined, the gate to Shub Nigoroth's dit will open, pit, and you can face the witch goddess herself in her frightful otherworld cathedral. If you're not first banned from Twitch. The third episode, The Netherworld. There's not, you know, this game isn't exactly... It's not exactly story heavy. It's just ancient, you know, it's like I said, there's an element of the old gods to Quake that I really like. I remember this level. There's an aspect to Quake that I think could be expanded on, but they ended up going more futuristic, which I think is a shame because, man, the gothic horror shit is great. But I guess Doom's got demons, so... Quake 2, no, Quake 2, I'm not taking away from Quake 2, because Quake 2 is like a classic, but... Just the setting alone... I was more of a fan of the weird castles. Otherworldly pits. Dits. Mm-hmm. no old gods here. Are we not men? Oh, good. Good, 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 good. How many fucking times have I gotten quad damage in this game, and I've only had a chance to use it on, like, one or two enemies? God damn it. You missed the big button. Shit. I didn't see it. Now I'm... I wonder if it's all Trent just doing the, like, oh! Or maybe he got, like, a friend to help him. Did you watch Castlevania Season 2? I had some pretty lengthy discussions about that season. And I loved it. And I can't wait for more. I can't wait for a potential time jump to different periods of the Castlevania lore. But we might be a little bit far away from that. I also like Trevor Belmont, like, too much. I was thinking the other day, man, it would be great if Trevor was the one in Smash and not Simon, but Simon's much more recognizable. It's just a weird... like, it's weird that he's a muscle-butt barbarian, man. It never fails to amuse me and surprise me. Yes. Yes. Scream. No, Richter's cool. I'm glad we got Richter. I'm going to be using Richter more than Simon, I can already tell. Why? Why, Vin? Why would you do this? Oh. Still, why would you do this? That was the big button I missed. No wonder I got quad damage and squan damaged it. Beep boop, I'm technology. Oh, you don't like that beep? Oh, it's, you know, it's designed to make you hate it. And uncomfortable. Some say it's the yellow note. You know what that is, chat? Well, you've heard of the brown note, so you can probably extrapolate the rest from there. Time? Damage in there. Huh. finally. Yes. Yes, quad damage! Everything must die. Yes! Oh, that totally made up for the lack of quad damage. That was some good ripping, some good tearing, some good gibbing. Everything is dead. So what's Quake Marine's deal? Like, he's in Quake Ultimate. Quake Champions? I should know the name of this fucking game, I have it. Quake Champions? But he doesn't look as much like a lumberjack as he does here. It should also be noted that the original Gordon Freeman was basically the Quake lumberjack. Ivan the Space Biker? No, he was a space biker? Oh, okay. He looked a lot like the Quake Marine. Quake Marine, Doom Marine. Wasn't exactly the most original time for characters. Didn't need to be necessarily. Now we have like people with backstories. Ramirez! Go pick that lock. We need to get in there. Ramirez! Make me a sandwich. Ramirez, shoot all the bad guys in the level. Sir, that's like 200. Yeah, that's what you're doing here. You got this. I believe in you, Ramirez. You got this. Okay, sir. And then you actually ended up gotting it. Did you know that the Call of Duty games are interesting because they really make you feel like Spider, like a badass. Oh, until you decide to walk like 3 feet away from the cover. Then everyone just targets you instantly and, you know, it's pretty much game over. But for a little while, you feel like you're Spider-Man. This reminds me of some- what does this remind me of? I know what this reminds me of. This reminds me of a fucking Thom Yorke album. The music here. Here. Tomorrow's Modern Box's pink section. Not entirely. The piano is less pronounced, but you hear it every now and then. I haven't listened to the Suspiria soundtrack yet. It takes me a little while to warm up to Tom Solo stuff. Here right now, I just hear cats meowing. You ever hear the expression, you're the cat's meow? It's like the cat's pajamas, but you're the cat's meow. Anyone ever said that, or is that a misnomer? Like, just someone saying it wrong? You've heard it? Okay. Cause it- I think it's just like, I've heard it... Why am I- this is like the most inane thing I could ever be talking about on the stream, but still, it's something that... It's something that I recall. I remember questioning it. Another one was 12 o'clock shadow. That was one I said. That was my mistake. You know the 5 o'clock shadow? It's like you come home from work, you got a little bit of scruff going from a long day. It's just having like, just like 2 days worth of non-shave. I called it a 12 o'clock shadow one time, and the person did not question me about it. And I was like, I guess that's right. And then years later, or maybe not even years, maybe just months, or whatever it was, I heard it correctly said as 5 o'clock shadow. And then I just thought intensely about that moment. And it pops up in my head every now and then. I'm like, well, why do I have to think about that? It's like such a minor thing. It shouldn't be like brought up in my memory as much. Like I don't remember good memories of like my family and I growing up. But I remember saying 12 o'clock shadow and feeling like a dick. The old brain yacht working as intended. Okay, chat, hang on. I do remember some good memories of growing up. But then I try to recall, like, vacation memories and some other ones, and I'm like, nope. Gone. It's all gone. Memory banks wiped. However, I do remember that embarrassing prom. Now, by that time, I was talking about Star Wars in class. Oh, man, I was so popular after that one. Nice fun, embarrassing moments that are- have overrode, like, cool moments. Then again, most of those cool moments were just me playing Smash Brothers with friends. Or Mario Party. What's the prom story? Well, there really wasn't a prom story, it was more of a kind of a general thing. My prom was just boring, I didn't... You know, the person I went with... we didn't really like each other that much. So, it was just kind of... You know, for show. Do I have to go to the prom? I don't want to go to this fucking thing! I don't even dance! You don't have to tell us, Vinny, haha. I swear it was nothing too embarrassing. There wasn't like a moment, there wasn't like an embarrassing incident. I probably wouldn't tell the stream anyway. But now that I brought it up, I'll just be totally honest with you. I did not have a good time at my 8th grade prom, and I did not go to my high school prom. Sucks, don't it? I lived. And then I got sick for my college graduation. I could not attend. I was, like, sick for like a week. I had like the flu. And, my parents thought I was lying. That was the worst part, if I could be honest. I haven't thought of this in 10 years. But now that we're on a tangent of memories, I'll... Okay. I didn't really like school very much. And I didn't like the pomp and circumstance song. Which is why I decided not to go to my graduation. No, I'm kidding. In reality, I just didn't care. It was, okay, it's fine, I'm graduating. I was late, so I wasn't like- And also, when you're in college, it's not like you know everybody. It's not like high school or wherever, like, where you have, like, an established connection with everyone. It's more like, oh, a bunch of random people from a bunch of random grades are gonna show up to this thing. So, but I, you know, and I made that known. But I genuinely got sick. And it wasn't psychosomatic. I was in bed for a week. And for a little while, my parents thought it was an elaborate ruse to get me out of the prom, the graduation. I can assure you now, chat, if you're listening to me, my hand to God,
I was sick.
Where are you getting that vomit from, huh? Oh. Oh, you can't eat. Oh. How come you look so sick? You're really good at faking it, huh? What is that, makeup? Piece of paper that cost me over $100,000. Now I think they believe me. You know what it was? I got sick early, and it was the graduation, like, the next day or two, or something like that. And then I was sick for, like, the next 5 days, and then they believed me. The story was more for effect, but the truth of the matter is, they didn't believe me at first for, like, the first couple days, and then eventually it was whatever. But even so, at that point, I was in my 20s. Didn't really matter. Good. That is good shit. When's the last time I saved? Oh, right here. Did you have to pay to go to graduation, or is it just my college? I don't remember. You pretty much have to pay for everything when you go to, like, private school. But I'll tell you this. I'm still getting letters from the school to this day telling me that I should, like, join up for some Founders Club or whatever the fuck they call it. It's not that at all. But they're just like, hey, you want to donate money to this thing? Like, they still want my money. Like, was having, like, debt until I was 32 not enough for you? Christ. You should donate to the church. You should donate to this. You should donate to this. You should pay for this new wing that we're renovating. It's like, yeah, I mean, I'm not that sentimental about this stuff. I wish you luck, but my time here is done. My time here is done, and thank you for the memories. I made some good friends. I learned a couple things. And now I am off to bigger and better things. Thank you. See ya. Bigger and better debt. Why they had to cut levels from the N64 version. I mean, it probably was a memory limitation, but how big are these? They can't take up that much data. Could they? Yeah, I guess so. Every level stores every texture in it. Sounds kind of inefficient. I just think back to, like, Doom 64, and that had a fuckload of levels. I think back to, like, Turok. Like, there's a lot of big games. GoldenEye was huge. Maybe they just used a smaller cart to save money. Duke 64 have any cut content? If anyone knows. A lot? Oh, really? Oh, so they had to really heavily sacrifice for the N64. Which makes Doom 64 even more of an anomaly, that it was not only its own fully featured game, but in some ways was bigger than original Doom. Well, not really, but it had, like, more textures, the visuals were better, the better lighting. The N64 was flawed. Yeah, it was a heavily flawed system. I mean, that's what knocked Nintendo off their perch. and then Square abandoned ship. And then, oh wow, Square has the biggest game of the fucking decade. Who would have thought? Just about. N64 was still great, though. I love the N64. I don't really think I want an N64 classic, but I love that system. And some of the games on it really hold up. I mean, well, with enhancements, let's say. When I played GoldenEye again, with the enhancements, it was great. Yeah. You guys see that Majora's Mask? I think we talked about this, but there... Some dude is doing a fan remake of Majora's Mask. Star Fox 64 has aged incredibly well. It's called the N64 HD project. I'll show you a little bit of the video. So I'll explain it to the best of my memory, because I'm going to skip ahead, but I think they're trying to get it to 30 frames a second instead of 20. But that is something that's more difficult because some of the animations are tied to the frame rate, which means that they'd have to fix that. So yeah, the dude is taking textures from the original game, mostly redoing them in HD from the original game, and then at times using the 3DS version as reference to see what they did with the textures. So, but none of the models are improved, if I'm not mistaken, yet. But I think that's something for the future of the project. Someone said, just play the 3DS version. Now, that's something that I thought, yes, just play the 3DS version, of course. But there are some pretty drastic differences that purists hate about the 3DS version. And, it did a lot of things. Here's the 30 frames a second enemy. You know, they have to fix that up. But yeah, the models are going to be improved. So I think it's cool. While the swimming is one thing, some of the boss fights, there's a couple things with the physics. There were some really deep, like... there was some, like, oversimplification of some enemies and boss fights. There's a video about it. I watched it. I don't fucking remember what it was. But the dude liked some of the 3DS version, but he didn't like a lot of the bigger changes. Way easier overall, too, for a lot of people. I liked the 3DS version, but it had been so long since I played the N64 version that I didn't remember a lot of the smaller details. So if they ever, like, finish that N64 HD thing, or if they end up doing the 30 frames a second, at least 30 frames a second, patch, I'll stream it. Yeah, I mean, it's always possible Nintendo will take them down, but I mean, they made their money from the fucking 3DS version. It's crazy. I mean, I get what they're doing, but it's still just a texture pack. It's not like it's... You know... It's not like a whole game remake. I don't know. They can do whatever they want, honestly. I just don't see why they would. If they were so concerned about losing money from it, they would just release Ocarina and Majora 3D on the Switch and make a fuckload more money. Hang on, this game is like a little loud now. And Ocarina is hitting its 20th anniversary in like, what, a week or two? Just under 2 weeks. Did I play this deathmatch over the net? I have in the past. I mostly play Deathmatch Classic. I don't know if I'm set up for multiplayer with this, nor do I feel like, you know, on stream looking it up, but if you want to play at some point in the future, I'd be down. Like, if we can figure out how to get a server going without, like, struggling on the stream tonight, I'd be down. Someone just said, Vinny destroys another niche online community. Or revives. I mean, take your pick. Even if it's just for one day. I might be down for some Quake multiplayer, though. I feel like when I'm done with the single player of this, I'm probably not going to want to touch it for a while. But we'll see. I'm open to it. Desert says that Norix might be able to set up a server. Norix is usually pretty on point when it comes to setting up servers for anything. And yeah, Joel, you have to mod the soundtrack back in. You have to download it and then put it back in, because the Steam version doesn't have the soundtrack. And if you want to get Quake going with the most, like, with the best engine for it now, and, you know, as opposed to, like, some blurry, kind of limited engine on Steam, there's a thing called Quakegasm that you- Oh, fuck! That you download that has a lot of, like, you know how Z-Doom and GZ-Doom are extremely customizable and really solid engines? It's basically that. So. And Quake is only $5. So what you have to do is you download Quakegasm, you put it in your Steam folder, and then you run it. And that's it. So you need the Steam version, unless you found a way around that. I mean, God bless you if you did. I couldn't. And I just said, you know what? It's a good game. Whatever. I'd like to own this. I'm surprised I didn't already, to be honest, in some fucking collection. Some Valve Quake collection. Back when Valve used to do really great sales on the Steam shop. Get like 10 games for fucking $7.99. Kind of the indie bundles serve the same purpose, but still, I miss those days. Vinny, when are Soul Calibur 6 streams? Next week. I burnt myself out on a little tiny bit. I'm gonna do more matches next week. I'm also gonna do more Red Dead next week. Wario World, we can finish next week. Probably finish Quake next week. Probably finish Zelda 2 Randomizer next week. But I have a couple other games in mind, too. I mean, hopefully I can get to all these games. Maybe I'll get the flu accidentally, you know, and not show up to my graduation. Like that time I had strep throat. Alright, chat? Remember when I had strep throat? That was rough, man. You know, I was thinking about streaming the whole time, too. It was really upsetting. Here I am, with strep throat. I'm like, man, it would be great to stream right now. You know, in between my cocktail and reading a book on the beach of Bermuda. I mean, when I was sick in my bed. I I can't stop. Move. Stop. Fuck. When did I last save? Oh man. I say that jokingly now, with some space in between, you know, now and when I was sick. But I probably lost like 10 pounds. That was awful. That was an awful thing. Vinny, when was your last vacation aside from being sick? I went to Atlantic City and Wildwood about 2 months ago, was it? So that's Jersey. Boy, do I know how to have a good time. I just go to New fucking Jersey. I don't know how to vacation. And it was only like one day each. Like a month ago? No, it was like 2 months ago that I went to the Hard Rock. The convention I went to in Atlantic City was 2 weeks ago, and that was not great. Oh, the lightning got me. Fuck off. Is this a secret level? You know what this song kind of reminds me of? Beginning of something that Reznor wouldn't do for like another 3 years, but like this one. Well, I say song, but these noises remind me of this. He makes good noises. Usually they're very fuzzy. Yeah. I wanna get VOD muted. That's fucking snare though. It's the Saint Anger snare. I love my favorite snare drum sound is like the Tame Impala one. It's so like pah! So good. Year Zero, I think it was called, Joel. Nine Inch Nails viral thing that they did. It's a concept album about like 20 years into the future. The sad thing is Trent almost got some of it right. Just not the part about the missiles yet. What was I gonna say? Yeah, you know what else has a really great sound? Fucking Ringo. I love the way Ringo's drums sound. I know that's half his playing and half the mixing. And, you know, another portion of that is the kit that he used. But also Jeff Emmerich, rest in peace, did a great job mixing Ringo's sound. Hang on, someone's knocking on my door.
Yes, hello? It's me, Ringo. Are you talking about my drumming? It's all me that sounds good. All me.
Sorry, Ringo. I'd like to let you know that Ringo just told me that it was all him that sounded good. And in fact, none of the mixing had anything to do with it. I mean, it sucks, but them's the breaks. I think Revolver was my favorite for Ringo's drum sound. Well, let me see. What was a good one for it? Rubber Soul, too. Oh, God, it's fucking full left ear. Not entirely. Okay. That's as much as I can play without getting in trouble. It's like 2 seconds. That's not enough to trip the sensor. It's true. Some YouTubers have got it down to a science. So if you watch a YouTube channel and they manage to play like... You're like, wait, why are they only playing 4 seconds of this one clip? They figured out exactly how much they can get away with. Through trial and error, and through various other means, like guides and such, and other pioneers of getting around that, and they figured it out. They did it. It's 6 seconds. Oh, so then I can play even longer. Here, let me play. Here you go. Check out this snare. Here we go, 6 seconds. Okay, that's 6 seconds. All right, now everybody knows the rules. Let's do another 6 seconds. Very crisp snare. Very crisp. He does a thing called close miking, but he mics it in a weird way, and he uses a level lock or a devil lock or something like that. I tried to get a similar sound one time, and not really. Couldn't really do it. But yeah, he mics it in a really interesting way. This is probably of interest to 7 people in the audience. Maybe 70 if I'm lucky. 7, maybe 70. That's the estimate I'm making at the moment, yes. But, I'm still an amateur to this stuff. Mixing and recording. I don't know what I'm doing, really. I can fudge my way. I'm learning. You know, I'm still playing with EQ to try to make stuff sound good. But it is a really fun hobby. The past week in particular, I've been booting up FL Studio a lot. And going back and remixing some of my demos, which I know are probably gonna, some of the parts will be used later. And it's fun. I use FabFilter for EQ and a variety of other ones, but mainly that one. I've been using the Kramer tape delay, tape stereo rather, and it's got a really good chunky thing. You can like chunk up something and crunch it up. I wouldn't be surprised if Zertner used it. Oh yeah, I do have a Spitfish. There's a plugin called the Spitfish, which I use. It's on right now for S's. It's a de-esser, and I have it as a part of my my chain currently. Hang on a minute. Let me see if I can get the Kramer in here real quick. I think I have it. Give me 1 second. I want you guys to... Yeah, I got it. I'm going to have to get a little bit of echo. You're going to have to hear 2 of me. But I want to throw that on my voice. I want you to hear how crusty I can get. Just for a second. Check. Just for a second. Also, this Spitfish does nothing. I'd like to let you know. It's kind of garbage. It doesn't really work in real time the way I wanted it to. So... C'est la vie. Kramer tape mono. Okay, neither Kramer loads. So that's squashed. Just knock that on the head. I don't know why it doesn't load. All right, I tried. It's worth a shot. It would have been interesting. You could hear some strange stuff. Tell me though, chat, can you hear? Tell me if you can hear this. Roads. All right, so some of it works. I might be trying to load it, the 64-bit into a 32-bit or vice versa. But I had it working on this thing at one point. Robot jazz, yeah. Oh, well. All right, well, music talk is over now. Let me throw... There we go. Okay. I use a thing called Mini Host Modular for anyone who is wondering. I do get this question like once every month or so. Oh. Which is, what do I use to compress my voice? It's all software. I'm not going to give the specific plugins because you could use anything pretty much. Just use what works for you. But Mini Host Modular is a free... It's a free program where you could load VSTs. It's lightweight, it's really good, and you can chain them visually so that you can send your voice through a number of different programs to EQ it, to balance, to get rid of the S's, to compress, to limit, and my delay is relatively small. It's like 0.2 seconds. Which is way better than the 1 second it was. I mean, many of you know this is something I had problems with for years. Where I couldn't figure out how to get less latency. And now I think my voice sounds pretty decent. I have decent compression, decent limiting. I mean, if I scream, you're still gonna know it's a scream, but it's not gonna blow your fucking ears out. And there's, you know, too much compression is also bad, because then you just start to sound like it's just, it starts to hurt your ears after a while. Damn. I'm gonna have to check, the VOD of the full sauce version of this and find out how muted it got. Like, is it, like, on a scale from 1 to 10, like, mega muted or less muted than that? Whole stream is gone and they deleted your channel. They preempted it. There was actually some, there was some weird thing that I saw. Someone posted that they got an email from Twitch. This is likely bullshit, but they interpreted their rules as you can stream movies as long as the VOD is not saved. Like, the only way they can take you down is if it manually gets flagged. It's bullshit. It's absolute bullshit. There was no, like, proof of this email. It was just, like, some Nightbot post. But there was a big debate on, like, oh shit, does this mean you can stream movies? And someone was like, yeah, the mods are okay with it, as long as you don't save the VOD. That sounds like a troll to get, like, 40,000 people banned. This is now a ghost town. 40,000 people used to live here. Thank you. Some of these levels are really clever. I know not- look, I don't even find a single fucking secret in that one. Again, it's just shoot, rinse, and repeat. But within that framework, they managed to figure out some really interesting things. Oh, it's getting late. I probably should stop around here. Air tube is sealed. I remember this level too. I like this level. I think I played this game like Turok. When I played it on N64. Maybe. I don't know if it was that customizable. This is gonna sound ridiculous, but I found the Turok control scheme to be the best for shooting on the N64. People hated it, people fought against it, people didn't understand it. I get it. It was weird, it was clunky. But you could make things kind of work with it. So for the record, your right hand, you'd press forward, backwards, left, right on the C buttons. That's how you moved, and then the left stick, the analog stick, the only analog stick on the N64, would be used to look around. So it was essentially, you know, like WASD on the right, and then on the left it was aiming. So you'd have to get used to it. It wasn't like it immediately, like, oh, this makes sense. It wasn't that. Why does Vinny say forward? Forward? Horward. H-O-R-W-A-R-D. Horward. He is the best. Horward. With him you do not wish to mess. Horward. Oh, so what was I saying? Yeah, I don't know. The Turok control scheme, though, was pretty okay for first-person shooters. It's just look spring was always the thing that sucked. When you're looking around and then it springs back. It's like, just let me look around. Jesus Christ. Also, someone said that's just Southpaw. I mean, you know, you can customize a lot of different control schemes in games these days. But you didn't have a lot of those options back in the day, so you just kind of had to work with what you had. And for Turok, it seemed ridiculous, and then it kind of just made sense. So whenever I could customize a game to be like that, I did. GoldenEye had auto-aim. But GoldenEye was awkward. A lot of the aiming was like, you were just fighting against the stick. Again, you get used to it. But you'd use the C-stick, the C-buttons rather, to aim. Which was not very precise. You kind of just had to, like, get in the ballpark of where you wanted to aim. But you could do a dual-wield thing, which I didn't realize until years later. You could use- GoldenEye would let you use two N64 controllers. It was- It's pretty fucking ridiculous now that I think about it, but it's- innovative. You could use two N64 controllers to get, like, essentially a dual analog stick set up. It's kind of forward thinking, isn't it? Oh, yeah. The game's control setup is its most terrifying element. The left analog stick moves you forward, back, and strafes right, left to right, right to left, while the right analog stick turns you and can be used to look up and down. I wonder what the reviewer's tilt was for this game. Zero, perhaps? You guys know about the reviewer's tilt? That was very controversial and confusing for people. GameSpot had a system where they would review games based on sound, graphics, control, replayability, and reviewers' tilt, and that would all add up to the final score of the game. And I think each one was weighted differently, so like sound wouldn't really weigh too much, but the other things would. And if the score was, say the reviewer liked the game, but it had problems, they could influence the final score of the game, because they had to add everything else up, and then they had to give the reviewer's tilt between a 1 and 10, and then they could use that to statistically weigh the score of the game higher or lower based on their personal preference for whether or not they liked the game. Now, maybe that's a little confusing. And I'm really trying my best to explain it, and I'm still not sure I'm doing a good job. They got rid of it eventually, but for a while that was like, you know, people would be like, why didn't you give it, this score? Like, and their scores were lower than IGN, because they did more, you know, they would add it up in such a way that it would kind of make their scores lower, so people would always get shitty with them. And then they would see the reviewer's tilt and be like, that's the real score of the game. If the reviewer's tilt is a 10, that means they think it's a 10 out of 10 game. When in reality, they just use that to influence the score a little bit lower or higher, as opposed to it being the actual score. Very confusing. Very confusing. Apparently it was confusing for fucking, like, the audience for years. Someone said, I see nothing wrong with that at all. I mean, I think it's an interesting idea, it's a good concept, but it just didn't register for people. And again, there was no easy way to explain it without going into full detail. So people would be like, what does reviewer's tilt mean? The score is too low. Why does GameStop hate this game that I love so much? You know how people are. You know how people are on the internet. 7.8, too much water. So, imagine you're a reviewer, and you get a death threat because you didn't rate a Pokemon game high enough, or whatever. So they got rid of reviewer's tilt, and I have no idea if that actually helped or made things worse, but... I'm getting confused. It's pretty late. I want to stop playing this. But late night debuff, exactly. Vinny, why do people care so much about reviews? If you enjoy the game, play it. People are broken. We're broken human beings. We like confirmation bias. We like knowing that the thing that we like is good. Because if you go to school and someone, and you say, oh, I like that Alien game, and then your friends say it sucks because it got bad reviews and they didn't even play it, you're gonna get picked on. That's one aspect of it. The other aspect of it is you don't want to be the odd person out in a group dynamic, which I don't know why we care about that as much as we do, but we're tribal, territorial. Well, maybe territorial is not the right word, but this is just me talking out of my ass, and I'm a dummy, so don't listen to me. But I think it's something to do with that. It's probably also like, what if you're a really big fan? What if I told you someone reviewed, now apply this to yourself. What if someone played Deltarune and said it was hot garbage, but you know you love it? You're gonna gang up on that person then. You're gonna find a way to tell them that they are, you know, they're wrong, they're shit. Not every one of you, but some of you. I think, reviews mean a lot to people. It's for better or worse. Huh. You know, like, if you play a game and you enjoy it, that's all that matters. If you like a movie, like, if you like The Last Jedi, but everyone is telling you that you're wrong for liking a thing, it's frustrating. It's like, who cares? You know, it's what you like. Or maybe you just have shit taste. I mean, that's possible too, but hey, wait a minute. Hey, wait a minute, that's mean. Though, some people don't have much of a filter for that kind of stuff. You know, some people don't have, or aren't as critical about things as other people. Reviewers, their job is to be critical. And why do people care about reviews? The final aspect, and this is the positive aspect of reviews, and this is why I do mention reviews on the stream from time to time when I discuss games, is because games are expensive. And not everyone can afford every video game. So if you see a game called Winback on the N64, you're like, what is this? Oh, this got a 9 out of 10. Interesting. Well, what is it? Huh. Oh, it's a shooter game. It does this, 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 and this. Interesting. And then you buy it, and then you just spent your money on a game that ended up being pretty good that you didn't know you would like. And then you found out that new Yoshi game is garbage. So you don't buy the new Yoshi game, but you buy Operation Winback on the N64 instead. And you spent your money wisely. Now, again, the whole thing about the Yoshi game is the reviews are subjective. That's just one person. So it's good to, like, find, like, 7 or 8 reviews. You know, 4 or 5. Back in the day, there weren't, like, amalgamators like Metacritic, so it was harder to do that. You had to just read the reviews, find them, maybe go to a forum, figure out if people that are fans of the genre of the game like it. Which I think is the best way to do it, instead of just listen to one website. I only go to IGN! Only listen to their reviews! They're the only ones that matter! Maybe not that great of an idea. But if you're short on cash and you want to know what game to pick up, do you pick up Mario Tennis or do you pick up Mario Party? Well, which game was better received? What was considered the one that people liked a little bit better? If you're stuck between the two, that's when it's helpful. I mean, this sounds like obvious stuff, but I have to articulate this every now and then so I don't feel like I'm crazy. So they're helpful. They can be helpful. They can also be, like, damaging and wrong. But that review, by the way, that Winback story was true. I don't know what the fuck Winback was on the N64, but people liked it. It came out of fucking nowhere, and it was like a third-person shooter game that actually had one of the first cover systems in video games. Like, you know how Gears of War has a cover system that you could just attach to the wall and then shoot? It was great. And people are just busy talking about Undertale. Never mind then. Alright, maybe that's a good time to end the stream. All I had to say was the word Deltarune one time. This is not... this isn't exactly unexpected, is it? All right, let's quit out of this. It's fine. It's too late anyway. I want to go to bed. I've been streaming for a while. I started late, so I wanted to go a little late. Tomorrow, Sunday stream. Come by for that. Next week, finish Quake. We will finish, hopefully, Wario World. Only one stream of Wario World left. It's fine, Joel. Don't worry about it. You didn't do anything. Everyone, listen. Undertale's a hot topic, you know, it's the thing. It's a hot button topic. It's no big deal. I was going to say, though, when it comes to video games that are underknown, I would definitely recommend Winback. I don't know if it aged well, but it's a cool game, and I liked it. So yeah, Wario World, Quake. And we'll finish the Zelda 2 run, hopefully. More Red Dead, Soul Calibur. That's next week. Tomorrow will be...